Welcome to China Tech Talk, the weekly discussion of technology and startups here in China. I am John Artman, editor-in-chief of technode.com, joined as always by Matthew Brennan, founder of China Channel. And so this week we had the pleasure to welcome onto the podcast Kai-Fu Li. He just published his book, AI Superpowers. We got a chance to talk to him about his book as well as some other things.
Yeah, indeed. I don't think Kai-Fu needs much of an introduction to many of our listeners. He's been doing so many things recently. His book is everywhere. I even have a copy myself given to me by a friend a couple of days ago, quite randomly. He didn't know, it wasn't anything connected to this interview today, but it just goes to show what a great job he's doing, what a hot topic this is as well. I think there's an intense global interest in what Kai-Fu's talking about in his book and what we're covering today.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that, and also when it comes to, voices, international voices about technology in China, I think that his is probably the most that you really want to listen to. Not only has he been around for in mainland China in technology for forever, he also has a very deep understanding of the technology itself, which we do talk a little bit about in the podcast. And so I think that one of the great things for me about the book, I've only read a little bit so far, is kind of some of the things that we've talked about previously on the show is kind of what the landscape used to be like. Because I think that a lot of people, when they encounter the internet in China, it's like everything. You kind of take it as is, and you assume that it's always been this way. But in the first section of the book, Kai-Fu takes us through this kind of a quick tour of what the landscape used to be like, and kind of sets that up for the rest of the book and why China is becoming so dominant or so powerful, let's say, in artificial intelligence. And I think that's a really, really important point, and I'm really glad that he was able to tell that story.
Yeah, I think it echoes a lot of the things that we've covered and been saying for a long time. About how China's got its own sort of thing going on, and in terms of the strengths of the companies here and the sort of fierce, intense work ethic, and also the environment is so different from the rest of the world now. We touch upon all this stuff, and Kai-Fu gives his own thoughts, and we move into at the end to some pretty big concepts as well about looking at the future. So I think without ado, let's get into it, John.
So Kai-Fu, thanks so much for taking the time to join us. I know that you're really busy these days.
Yeah, well, thanks for inviting me.
So for our listeners who aren't aware, around 9 years ago, you headed up Google China until they made the choice to pull out of the China market. So during that time, you helped to grow their market share to around 24%. So can you give us just like a brief overview of kind of your time at Google and how you got into it and why you decided to leave?
Sure. I joined in 2005 to start Google China. And at the time, Google's market share was down to single digits, about 8 or 9%. And I thought Google was a great company, great brand, great products, great technology, great people. So I amassed a fantastic team and built really, I think, what was the best Chinese search engine ever. And that won us back shares up to about 24%. Towards the end of my tenure in 2009, I saw that most of my star performers had left. And what I saw was that they were jumping into the Chinese entrepreneurial scene. And I thought that would be the new beginning that we could all have together. So I also resigned and started a venture capital firm to fund, of course, people from all kinds of companies. And that turned out to have been a great move because we saw the advent of China Mobile, China becoming an innovator, and now artificial intelligence. 3 months after I left, Google decided to pull out of China.
Wow. Okay. So, Kai-Fu, it's obviously a very difficult decision on Google's behalf then to go for re-entry. It's really kind of a minefield in China. They are smart people. They must know how difficult it's going to be if they are seriously considering to come back into China despite having best-in-class technology. Why do you think they've come to the conclusion that regardless of the difficulty of the market, that they must come back. And obviously the market's big and has plenty of potential revenue to be earned, but I sense there's something more driving this. And what's your take?
Yeah, well, I can't speculate why they're making decisions now. But what I can tell you is that in 2005, the market was still forming for many areas. So whether it was search or some other area like social, e-commerce, I think all the multinational American players had their chance. And by not entering or not doing well, or in Google's case, withdrawing in 2009, the China marketplace, as I mentioned in my new book, has completely evolved into a parallel hyperspace. So China and US now have completely independent parallel spaces in which there are different puzzles. Now think about our mobile apps as pieces of puzzle plugging in together, all working well to service us as a mobile user. Now, US has its puzzle. China now has its puzzle. And to take one piece out of one puzzle and put it in the other, it's just not going to work. So Google had their chance with 24% share. Had they maintained the share or grew the share, I think they'd be in a great position as the only company that could cross the two parallel universes. But by pulling out in 2009, re-entering is a completely new story because the window to the parallel space has closed, and the local companies have filled in all the gaps. Now to establish a new brand, new technology is going to be a significant uphill struggle.
Interesting. So let's take it as a hypothetical situation, right? Let's say hypothetically, Google Search, their flagship product, does come back into China today. How would you see that battle playing out? And what would you think would be realistic market share for them to take back?
Well, there is no battle, no market share. No one here, the young people have not heard of Google. And older people have existing habits of using WeChat, Baidu, and other products. Switching people over could be, 1% a year, maybe for 2 years. And then that's it.
I just thought Google still has a pretty good reputation now in China. It's a very well-respected company, isn't it?
Yeah, among the most educated people, business people, PhDs, scientists, of course. But that's 0.3% of the population.
We do want to talk a little bit more about artificial intelligence, as well as some of the really interesting points that you've made in your most recent book, AI Superpowers. So I had a bit of skim over it the last couple of days. And I think that one of the things that I really appreciated was at the beginning, you really take a deep dive into the history of the Chinese internet and taking a look at some specific use cases, in particular Lao Zhou from Qihu 360, as well as Wang Xing, now of Meituan fame. So I'm curious, can you talk a little bit about why you felt it was necessary to give this history of the Chinese internet? And then, why are you choosing to write this book now?
Okay, so three questions.
Yeah, sorry.
First, let's start from the last question. Why did I choose to write this book now? I feel there are a lot of non-AI experts writing a lot of books about AI, and also articles and opinions and op-eds, and it's quite dangerous because they each may have significant flaw in their understanding or draw the wrong conclusions based on that flaw. That's why I don't write papers on, international politics or philosophy or history politics. Or economics, but they do. So this is quite dangerous. I feel like an expert really needs to tell it like it is. What is going to happen? What things are science fiction? What things are real? And then among the real things, I think there are a number of considerations, especially job displacement, we need to be careful about. And also, I wanted to talk about China because AI will not be a single U.S. engine driving it forward, but will be China-U.S. dual engine that are actually quite complementary. So the name AI Superpowers reflects that. And hopefully, the book will have fresh, new, and accurate information about what is AI, what can it do, what are the dangers, and why is China going to be a superpower. So coming to your second question, so that's why I wanted to talk about China as an AI superpower. So before I could just go in and say, here's why China's going to be an AI superpower, I think there are a lot of prejudices, misunderstandings about China. So I wanted to clarify it by explaining that the general perception that China is a copycat that once was true, but is no longer true. And the general belief that it was about IP theft and government protectionism, it is definitely not true. In the space we're in, it's all about execution. Very strong entrepreneurs like Zhou Hongyi and Wang Xing, I chose them because they were what I call the gladiators, people who drove things forward for the goal of business success and did whatever it took and played in the winner-take-all game and came up with innovative and process excellence types of ways to win, which is different from Silicon Valley way. So I think that description has the purpose of dispelling the myths about China and also maybe presenting Silicon Valley way isn't the only way. And then moving on to AI, AI is very much built on that spirit. That is, these entrepreneurs are the types of entrepreneurs who are driving AI forward because their culture of winner take all, working really hard, operational excellence, making AI perform and deliver business goals. These are the very reasons why China is strong in AI. Not because some brilliant mathematician published a great paper. That's the American strength. But the strength in China is getting tens of thousands of engineers and whatever else it takes to work together to use AI to make a difference in the business. So it was the same gladiatorial mindset and working 100 hours a week work ethic that made the Zhou Hongyi and Wang Xing successful with their internet businesses that their employees or their disciples or other entrepreneurs are going about AI the same way. And that's why I'm certain that China will be successful in AI in the implementation and delivery creation of value.
Mm-hmm. And one of the things that you point out is that in some ways, Silicon Valley companies, they're not as effective in a certain sense because they're kind of tied to, you know, this sense of mission or the sense of certain values that they have to stick to. And so the product and how they actually conduct their business is quite different. Whereas in China, they're not really constrained by that.
Well, I mean, I have great admiration for Silicon Valley. I think its model will also evolve many great AI companies and other companies. I just think China has come up with a different model, a model that really goes heavy into operational excellence, not afraid to hire a million people, and then to get them to, together with technology, change the way people do things. So I think it's just two different models, not one better than the other. And I think, both are very suitable for business school studies. And also I think when the Chinese people start companies, they study both the U.S. and China models, but in the U.S. side, people only study the U.S. model, so they're missing half of the textbook.
Yeah, I really like the language you're using here, describing them as gladiators, and how I totally agree that the business models in China, they're very high moat, strong moats, and willing to do the dirty work to defend their business. But when we see them, like Chinese companies, go outside of China, what's holding them back from competing better outside China, do you think?
I think the early days, the Chinese companies tried to compete with US in countries where American technologies will be dominant for a long time, maybe forever. And that was a mistake. This includes Baidu's effort to go to Japan, WeChat trying to go to US and Europe, and they've generally not been very successful. But I think the Chinese companies now are looking at expansion as a gradual process and a partnership process, and also going to countries where US is weak or is does not view as a priority. So Southeast Asia, Africa, Middle East, India are some of the countries in which the Chinese companies are finding partnerships locally and sometimes building their own products, sometimes finding partnerships. And with the partners, the Chinese companies would inject capital as well as technology, including AI technology, that would help the local companies to be well armed against the American giants. So examples of this include, a number of Uber competitors locally have not been able to measure up to Uber's backend and app and use look and feel and also AI behind it. But Didi, after they make the investment, quickly improve the technologies too. So I think the Chinese approach is to go after the developing countries or underdeveloped countries and to inject capital and technology and to aim to win not all of it, but to have substantial ownership in a lot of local companies so that this more populous group of countries could have a greater Chinese influence, while the developed countries are more or less game over. That is Europe, US, Japan, Australia, Canada. Those are pretty much 100% American technologies, and there's no point for China to try that anymore.
So you've said many times that there will be this US-led internet, AI and technology universe, and a Chinese-led one for companies jumping between these two parallel worlds will become increasingly difficult. So can you elaborate on this thesis and provide some practical, detailed examples to our listeners of the kind of barriers these companies face? And so can we expect companies to learn from the previous mistakes of their peers?
Sure. For example, in China, there are actually three types of users. There are the more white-collar users, and then there are the young users in smaller towns, and then there are sort of rural users. And their usage patterns are even different within China. So that's one difficulty of how to build, decide which segment to build for, and how they relate to each other. For example, the last layer, they actually don't know e-commerce. They use a website called Pinduoduo, and that is a social gamification of buying overstock products. And in terms of social, the middle market uses two products called Kuaishou and TikTok or Douyin. These two products are valued at about $40 billion total. And by the way, Pinduoduo is about $20 billion. And then these two products offer video-based social networking. And that's something that doesn't even exist in the US. So if you were an American, let's say, e-fashion designer, retailer wanting to come to China, well, all the ways that you have used on Pinterest or Lookbook or whatever doesn't work anymore. It's all about, the KOLs that are in the TikTok network. So you have to learn that brand new. All the work you've done in payments don't work anymore because people use WeChat Pay and Alipay. All the work that you learned how to do advertising on Facebook and Instagram, they don't work. They're completely changed. And if you think about the China world as a one-to-one correlate with the US world, well, you'd be wrong here, because there is not a correlate of Facebook. Tencent is actually a giant company with multiple products, as well as payments and investments into its commerce portals. So your relationship with these companies will be quite tricky. And also, the building a brand, winning users, how to acquire users is very different. Even when I was at Google, the primary way in which we acquired user was to pay for traffic. That's something that's unheard of in the U.S. But if you don't do it in an early stage, there's no way to win any share in the market. So all these things are incredibly different and unusual. And that's why no American company has been successful in the space. So my advice to any American companies thinking about entering China is just no, don't do it. Unless you have a Chinese partner that you license the technology to and that you trust and that you can work with, then maybe you can go somewhere. Another way to look at it is the two parallel universes don't compete, don't talk, are completely, basically unrelated. So if you think about a company like Google and Baidu, well, they ought to be competing, but they don't go to the same countries. So Google would consider Amazon a serious competitor because of they're in a lot of same spaces like cloud and speech. but Baidu is not anywhere on their competitor list. Similarly, if you ask Alibaba, who are they concerned about? Well, they're concerned about Tencent encroaching on the payment. They wouldn't for a minute think that Amazon was their competitor. So we've really grown these two countries as though they were two parallel universes or two planets. So to take, a Martian and land in China and say, hey, do business, that's just ludicrous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and looking at the history of foreign attempts to enter the market, it's littered with these failures of exactly that, where they came in trying to apply the exact same lessons, trying to use the same technologies and the same processes, and of course just falling flat on their faces.
Yeah, and another significant issue is the foreign companies send a professional manager, typically a professional sales manager, to run the quote unquote country. So the U.S. internet company head or general manager or president of China is a sales head who got promoted, say, into from Germany to China, a bigger country. And their ambition is, lowball the numbers, make the corporate satisfied that they beat their lowball quotas, and then promote them back to corporate to be a senior VP. So how are these people who lowball numbers and do sales, can they possibly compete with the gladiators who know every detailed feature of the product and how to win every type of competition, from PR media to recruiting to branding to sales to channels to execution to products to features? So, it's not only a parallel universe issue, but basically you're sending, a college professor to fight a well-seasoned general with a big army.
So speaking of winning, and kind of going back to the topic of AI, so one of the things that we hear a lot from observers in media is that China is going to win, quote unquote, the AI race. So is it possible to win? What would that look like? And you've mentioned it in passing just a few minutes ago, but what are some comparative advantages between the U.S. and China when it comes to AI?
Yeah, I'm frustrated that media comes to that conclusion, and some of them feel my book supports it. Actually, my belief is that U.S. is incredibly strong in research and technology and will probably lead for the next 20 years, if not longer, for research and technology. China is stronger in building, implementation, and also has a ton of data to improve the landing, monetization, and acceptance of the technologies. So China may make more money because the market is bigger and AI is fed on data, and China has a ton of data, more users and more data per user. And Chinese entrepreneurs are tenacious, hardworking, and there's more capital coming into China. So if by winning you mean which country will make more money in the next 5 years on AI-driven businesses, I do think China will probably win that numerical comparison. But I think U.S., I think the biggest bet opportunity for U.S. is to come up with the next technological breakthrough, in which case the game will be changed. And also, of course, to build the most complex products where the American leadership of technology matters. Let's say autonomous vehicles, where U.S. clearly has an advantage because the technology injected into that is complex. And mm-hmm. by being ahead in technology, U.S. could lead that if policies, unions, and liability don't slow U.S. down. Whereas doing something like ads targeting, loan approvals, customer service replacements, figuring out simple robotics for inspection, well, China will be just as good as U.S. in technology, but monetized much better because the market is larger and the data is more more in quantity.
Yeah, and that's what's kind of what's really interesting, and what you hear most often when it comes to artificial intelligence in China is just the amount of data that is available to companies who have the technology and willingness to create products around that. I don't want to get too into the weeds when it comes to machine learning and deep learning, but can you just give us just a very quick kind of overview of why the amount of data that China has is so important?
Sure. It's because the specific technologies we have, generally called machine learning, and the most powerful of which is generally called deep learning, they're incredibly hungry for data because the technologies don't really understand in the sense that humans understand. They are just making up for their lack of understanding by having so many exemplars that it covers all the edge cases. In fact, more than people do. So imagine, you know, we're driving 30 miles of road per day, but someday an autonomous vehicle could have 100 million people each drive 30 miles, and it would have 3 billion miles of samples. And that would help it look at all the edge scenarios of, you know, a little child jumping behind the car, in front of the car. It would capture a lot of those permutations. Similarly, in all the applications we've seen, whether it's training for reading radiology, CT reports, or targeting ads for Amazon, just by seeing so many permutations of all the people who've gone to Amazon who have bought and not bought things at each moment, all that becomes training data for deep learning so that it can predict future people whether they're likely to buy or not. So the algorithms are a mathematical way to look at all the correlations of all the users and all their behaviors and all the predicted actions. The more the data, the better it works. It doesn't actually give you a human-like explanation. It wins because it can look at so many dimensions of data and so much depth of data. And when you give any engine, 10 times, 100 times more data, it will automatically perform much better. Like from the time I did my PhD work till now, so about when I started in 83 and to now, 35 years from the day I started my PhD, the amount of speech data that's used to train a typical speech recognizer has increased by 1 million times. And that is the primary reason, combined with deep learning, that caused speech recognition to be beating human accuracy, even though 35 years ago, it was nowhere.
Yeah, and that makes me, what you mentioned just there with speech, made me think. Yeah. I was watching some videos of lip reading algorithms coming out now. That's the sort of next level of how speech recognition is going in this direction. It's actually amazing. But I want to take this on a slightly different direction and just ask about, China has a long history of grand projects. And as you pointed out in your book, China's doing this also with AI. How do you think, government support is affecting the development of AI in China?
Sure. The government support is very helpful. But to be fair, AI started, those of us who started investing in AI 4 or 5 years ago, we did so because we saw deep learning was starting to show very promising results, not because of any government effort. Government really didn't get into the game until about a year and a half ago. But once they start to participate, they're doing a lot of things that are very, very helpful. One is in building infrastructure. So new cities are being built for autonomous vehicles. The downtown areas are in two levels, the top level for kids and pets and bicycles, and bottom level for cars, which will minimize the types of accidents we saw in Uber and Phoenix not too long ago. Actually, a province is building a new highway with sensors that can talk to autonomous vehicles. So these are very large ticket projects. Imagine building the city, a city the size of Chicago. It's incredibly expensive, but the completion of which will become the perfect place to test autonomous vehicles. The second way in which the Chinese government supports AI is the central government through the state council would write a white paper. The paper itself doesn't carry any funding, but it sends a very strong message, sets the tone that AI is one of the top few national level priorities. And local governments then may decide, one local government might say, we have good universities, let's start an AI entrepreneur park. Another city might say, we're very good in manufacturing, let's figure out what AI can do for manufacturing. And a state-owned bank might say, oh, we haven't before bought any AI software, maybe we should buy some. So this central level setting the tone does really allow various companies and cities to embrace and support AI in their own ways and in very individualistic and usually very smart and targeted ways. So these are probably the two primary primary ways in which the government has helped AI.
Do you think there's any danger that, you know, when government indicates in China that this is the future, this is the way, that suddenly everyone floods in and it creates a sort of bubble? Could there be some negative effects there?
It's possible there's some bubble in AI everywhere, and probably a little more in China. But because there is sustained value in AI, I think the companies that are really building good technologies will end up, whether their valuation is two times what it should be, it doesn't really matter, because, you know, in another year or two, they'll catch up and to still do great. I do worry about a larger number of people who are actually not building true AI companies, but they have, you know, maybe someone from Google, someone from MIT or something like that. They package themselves as an AI company and get an unfairly high valuation. I think many of those companies will be going out of business in probably the coming months. Some already have. So that will cause specific companies that have overpackaged and oversold their capabilities, they will pay the price. But AI as an endeavor or a direction, and the truly good AI companies and the truly good AI investors, I think they'll be in fine shape.
Yeah, and so speaking of investment and investors, after you left Google in 2009, you went on to found InnovationWorks. Now it's called Synovation Ventures. So you know, what's it like being a player in this kind of space? I mean, so the market in China for VC is extremely competitive. So, you know, when you're looking at investments, when you're looking at other VC firms that you might be competing, how do you tend to position yourself?
Synovation Ventures, we are the tech VC, in the sense that we understand technology. We understand technology trends. When we see a trend, we'll invest early, get in early, and that will advantage us to see things earlier than other people. And we are very technical, so we would not make mistakes and invest in a company that's a packaged AI company rather than the real one. Also, we have a very strong brand as a tech VC, not just in China, but globally. So we have, ability to help them, to raise more money, to connect to business. So I think as a result, we've been in business for 9 years, which is a somewhat young VC, but whether it's in the ranking of the VCs or whether it's the actual return on investment, we're always ranked as among the highest in China. Our last fund, there was about a 3x desire to invest than we were able to accept money. So that's obviously based on not just, you know, our credentials, but based on the actual numbers that that investors saw and they want to be a part of, getting some of the highest returns that's available anywhere.
Yeah, and it's really interesting to hear you position yourself as a technical or a technology VC, because usually when I ask VCs, like, how do they evaluate a company, they usually the usual answer is, well, we look at the team, but it seems that you guys look at something very different.
Oh, certainly we look at the team, but we look at the team not just in, you know, are they a good team? Can they execute? Do they have experience? Which, of course, all the VCs do. But we also look at them on whether they know what they're talking about in terms of technology trends, competition, whether they're a tech company. If so, what are their credentials and can they do it? So I think we do everything the other VCs do. Plus, we have about 12 PhDs on our team. So we actually understand AI and other technologies rather well.
And as you mentioned, you have investments in China and you have investments in the States. So, I mean, how would you describe some of the differences in those VC environments? Is it kind of similar in terms of what we see in entrepreneurship, where China seems to be very competitive, very fast, whereas not saying that Silicon Valley isn't competitive or fast, but there is that difference in pace and mentality?
Yes, we clearly notice that. I think our U.S. investments have been in the very technical companies, people with very unique skill sets, and the Chinese companies tend to be stronger in execution. We also noticed that Silicon Valley companies tend to be multi co-founders. So 2 to 3 co-founders might be a sweet spot with roughly, not too different shares ownership. But in China, usually we invest in one founder company. There may be co-founders, but really one company takes the lion's share of the company shares. because that's what allows for the gladiatorial decisive winner take all. One person basically shoulders all the responsibilities, challenges, and the urge to succeed, and the risk of failure and the responsibilities for all decisions. So that has been a very significant difference, not usually noticed, but the Chinese single founder situation is what is compatible with the gladiatorial style. The US multi-founder approach is more suitable for the equal and complementary and consensus building and technology vision driven approach that has bound the multiple founders together.
Yeah, and it strikes me that's also a very interesting kind of cultural difference as well in general, where, I mean, like you look at educational systems, for example, where in the U.S., teamwork is highly emphasized, especially as you get into secondary and university education. And then whereas in China, you know, kids usually end up kind of working by themselves, studying their butts off, memorizing as much as possible, and then taking tests by themselves.
Yeah. I think it relates to culture. It relates to I think the traditional companies follow the similar pattern. I think the Chinese tends to be the top person makes all the calls. And to the extent you have a good person at the top and a meritocracy, then the company will do well. And then the employees basically are going along for the ride, but with a strong faith that the leader will get them to the promised land.
So kind of taking a step back, looking at some broader questions, in particular about artificial intelligence. So, in the book, you mentioned the Kejie match with AlphaGo and how it inspired some hope for you. As an amateur Go player myself, I was really fascinated by some of the commentary that was being made, in particular that Go players around the world had adjusted their tactics and strategies, not only to deal with AlphaGo, but also they were learning actually how to better play the game. And it was really interesting how, you know, AlphaGo, it actually like went back and revived certain strategies and tactics that hadn't been used for centuries in Go. And so for me, it really highlighted the fact that AI, it's not necessarily a threat, but we actually have a lot to learn from these algorithms and from these programs. And so I'm curious for you, you know, where is that silver lining with artificial intelligence and AI and human interaction?
Yes, I agree with you that for many professional jobs of the future, scientists, writers, and lawyers, doctors, wealth planners, they will all want to have an AI tool that can help them seek opportunities, validate hypotheses, and significantly improve whatever metric it is that they use to measure their work, like a scientist for how many drugs discovered in the next 10 years. A wealth planner, you know, what's the return on investment for the portfolio you manage? When it's human plus machine for these professions, I think it will be a big improvement over either for some period of time. Now, over time, it's possible that AI can surpass human in some of these professions. But at least I think for the next 20 years, we're looking at a 1+1=3 kind of a scenario, and that's great. That's the human-machine symbiosis, using AI as a tool to filter, validate, test hypotheses, and so on, working with the human intuition, planning, and creativity, which the AI lacks. But the other thing I saw in the Kejie match was that he was overtaken by emotion because he loved the game. And he came to tears. And that I think that's another thing that AI does not have. It doesn't have any true self-awareness or emotion, and nor would a human want to be comforted or taught or cured by an AI. So lacking the ability to create that trust with a human being, AlphaGo beat Kejie but felt no joy. No desire to hug someone, and if it lost, it would feel no sadness. If someone turned it off, it will also feel nothing. So its AI is just like software. It's like Excel or Word. It's just cold bits running on a computer. So it has no warmth. So that speaks to the other possibility and angle of where the future of humanity might be, is that in addition to being tools that help amplify our creativity, people should also go after the compassionate jobs, the jobs that require empathy, compassion, connecting with humans, winning trust, the human-human connection kinds of jobs, some of which require very little training, some of which require a lot of training, some of which might use AI, some of which might not. But I think that's a large category and group of jobs that we currently don't consider to be very attractive jobs. We call them service jobs. But I think in the future, they'll be increasingly important because they're one of the few things that AI cannot do.
Could to play devil's advocate here, Kai-Fu, could that not, you know, something we consider like compassion, be broken down into sort of its composite parts and be imitated, you know, through a personal assistant, a voice assistant, you know, giving you that comfort, giving you that connection?
That's a possibility, and it will take a long time to improve it. A couple of problems with it. I think first, AI is trained on large amounts of data and objective labeling. The person bought the book, the person repaid the loan, the stock went up yesterday, the goal match was won or lost. Those are objective ways in which we teach the deep learning. Now, emotions are not so objective, so I think the teaching process will be tougher, right? Is this person in anxiety? Does he or she need comforting or just have them vent or... what's the right soothing voice, or how do you make them feel better? Do they need medicine? Is this a medical condition? So these things are much fuzzier and non-objective, so not so suitable for deep learning. But having said that, you're right. A system could still fake it. The question is, how good can you fake it? And so far, based on the efforts companies have tried, not very good, right? If you look at Microsoft Tay that was released on Twitter, it very quickly started talking like people, but it also cursed a lot and made inappropriate racial remarks and had to be removed in 24 hours. So that points to another AI weakness, is that even though you can optimize some objective function, such as the number of turns of conversation, which is what Microsoft Tay was optimized on, then you forget about the side effects of you know, doing whatever it takes to get more lengthy conversations going on. So I think the catastrophic failure and not having common sense. If you had common sense, you wouldn't say that. A human would never say that. And then it comes down to, if you have catastrophic failure, one such failure, you'll lose the trust completely. So these all point to difficulties of why we can't build a substitute for a psychiatrist or elderly companion or a nanny or someone or social worker. But there will be efforts to try, and they'll make some progress. Maybe there will be 10% of the users who feel that's helpful to them. But I would not project in the next 15 years those social jobs become replaced by AI.
Got it. Right. So you're basically saying common sense is very, very difficult, but maybe narrow scenarios, something like we saw with Google, with the booking system they have with that natural voice, which they demonstrated this year, which blew everyone away. But that's a sort of narrow case scenario. That stuff definitely possible, but stuff that requires a wider range of inputs and more possibilities could be is that still actually very, very difficult.
Exactly. And, selling a ticket, making reservation for a trip, getting a customer service ticket filled, those are all very similar one-to-one. But when it comes to emotional, chatting, venting, comforting, even if you said you build a chatbot for someone who broke up with his or her boyfriend or girlfriend. Every case is, again, so different. I'm not certain you can do it to the same degree as a human. And finally, another reason is, even if you did fake it pretty well and don't catastrophically fail too much and works almost as well as people, still there's the issue of how many people would want to seek out a machine psychiatrist, or how much would an elderly person want to talk to a machine rather than a human. I would contend that even if technology progress was made, people would prefer not to use the machines, at least for the next 40 or 50 years. So if we're projecting for the next 10 to 50 years, we need to significantly increase this kind of service jobs, and move people into them, it seems fine for half a century. After that, we can always reevaluate whether technology improvements are made.
I mean, I think that's really interesting, and kind of as a way to start really kind of wrapping this up. I mean, one of the things that I've been thinking about, and I think that, you know, in a certain sense you've already addressed this question, but I do want to drill down a second, because one of the questions that I've been really thinking about the last year or so is, you know, for China specifically, you know, what exactly is the game plan, or what's going to happen? Because, you know, the demographic dividend has been based upon, you know, lots of cheap labor. You know, the party that rules this country is based upon, you know, putting workers first. But, you know, Yuval Noah Harari, in his recent book and in Homo Deus as well, one of the things that he talks about is how more and more workers are going to become irrelevant. So, you know, what is that going to look like for China? Is it something similar to as you were just describing, or do you think it might look a little bit different?
I think China would be similar, and I would push back on Professor Harari a bit by saying, yes, if we measure purely by economic output, many people's jobs, when they're replaced by AI or automation, will face that challenge. However, if we believe there is a large number of jobs that have to do with human interaction, social jobs that have some economic value, but just need to be maybe enhanced in compensation to become more attractive, then that is a large enough group for people to migrate to. For example, in elderly care, there are a million positions open, but because they don't pay enough, not enough people apply for them. And as all people in the world have reached longer lives, people over 80 need 5 times as much as elderly care. So that number will go up. There will be jobs like doctors and teachers that can also go up because AI can do most of the going to medical school for the doctor. So the doctor needs to just be very good in using the AI tool and interacting with the patient to get all the symptoms and family history and then reach the right diagnosis. So one could make a case that the category of doctors and teachers are clearly not enough today because there are many poor countries. If we can really reap the dividend from AI and make $17 trillion as PwC estimates by 2030, a lot of that money can go into redefining teachers and doctors, making them more companionship one-on-one mentoring and humanistic jobs. So if the number of elderly caretaker doctors and teachers and probably 100 professions I haven't figured out and studied, each goes up 5 or 10 times in the world, that might be enough positions to retrain the people so they don't fall prey into this unemployable and living on social welfare kind of a status. So my hope is, just as we saw a huge successful, difficult but successful transition from agriculture to manufacturing economies, we might see another from the routine job to the empathetic job as a direction for the next 15 to 20 years.
So Kai-Fu, again, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. It's been a super interesting discussion for us, and it's always good to hear your thoughts on some of these issues.
Thank you. If the readers are interested, they can find me at Kai-Fu Lee on Twitter, and also the book AI Superpowers has a website, aisuperpowers.com, and all my new writings will be on it.
Perfect. And we'll make sure to put that in the show notes. And that's about all the time we have for this edition of China Tech Talk. As always, if you enjoyed this episode, we'd really appreciate it if you left a review on iTunes, or if you're on Pocket Cast or Overcast, you can tap on that star button and it will recommend this episode to your network.